welcome to Heliotropes. My name's Julia.
My name's Kwadjo.
My name's Pele.
Hey!
He's our first guest!
Yeah!
And we are, so what we're talking about today is, today is, March 6th, which is Ghanaian Independence Day, so we're going to be talking about that a little bit. And in a broader context, right, so we're not just talking about Ghana, but we're going to talk about, the situation of African people all over the world, neo-colonialism abroad and here, and how it relates to things we usually talk about, racism, capitalism, all the things. And we're going to share our reflections on all these things as well. So this is going to be we're really excited to have you on here.
I'm excited to be here.
This is also our first outdoor show since the protest.
Oh, yeah.
It's been a minute.
That was a good show that you took off. I was so upset. That was my favorite one.
We'll bring it back at some point. Yeah, mine too. I really enjoyed
that.
Yeah,
it was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's just, there was so much truth in there, Got to let that one simmer for a little bit. Yeah. Word.
I'm already shadow banned, so
All right, we'll bring it back.
So do you want to start and give us a brief overview of Ghanaian Independence Day and some history?
Yeah. So the whole thing is Ghana was one of the first African nations to achieve flag independence. And that's just, the kind of cynical name for it. Because all these countries got big independence, but the independence was the colonizing countries essentially said, we're gonna let you run all your stuff, but we're gonna maintain control of your businesses, maintain control of your economy, your resources, things like that. And then getting into the whole setup of the international regimes and everything, the ICC and the World Court, World Bank, all these big financial institutions, not even financial, just organizational in general, so flag independence. But 1957, Kwame Nkrumah, first president of Ghana, presides over Ghana during its, independence, and that's the big deal, brief rundown of the history. World War II happens, fucks up everybody's shit. A lot of people don't know this, but Africa was a huge theater in World War II, right? We're talking about, all the resources that Africa had been, had been siphoned out of Africa ever since, the age of exploration, that went into European hands, that went into all these people's hands, well, mostly European hands, and then American hands later on. World War II, there was big theater in Ethiopia, with Italy versus, and Germany versus, the Allied forces, big theaters in the northern Africa. But bottom line is, after that war, Europe was destroyed and bankrupt, and they were really in dire straits, right? And to run colonial operations, it takes a certain number of resources, not to mention all the resources that they get out of it. So this was coming out of the Great Depression, where, Europe was already having a hard time. Going into World War II, where Europe had an even harder time. And basically they were all these people who are, right? And I guess that's the big thing about it is, and this is kind of when my story was something James Baldwin spoke about a good bit, independence in these movements wasn't Europeans being generous, or Europeans being hey, we can't run your country anymore, how about you have it? It was African people, coming out of these wars, African Americans in the, states, when we think about the Civil Rights Movement and things that started that, a large part of that was GIs coming back from abroad and being fuck if we go and fight over there, for liberation in this country, and then we come back to some racist Jim Crow South, bullshit. So that was a huge part of the consciousness. And a similar thing was happening, all of these African regiments, going fighting at home and in, abroad in other countries in Africa, you know, and the kind of same stuff still happens to this day. But I guess long story short, it got really expensive for Europe to hold on to African colonial possessions, and then also African people started to come into, you know, a consciousness of independence, right, and self-worth, and like nationalism, right? So that led to these movements, right? People like Kwame Nkrumah, he was born in Ghana, but he was educated, you know, in like England, right? Right. Marcus Garvey as well, right? Like similar situations. And that's kind of like the thing, you know, it's like promising young like African people go and, you know, a lot of them get that Western colonialized education, and they begin to subscribe to the colonial system. But then there's like the exceptions, like Garvey, Nkrumah, Lumumba, any number of people, right, who take it the other way, right? They say, okay, how about these Enlightenment ideals over here that, like, you know, the founding fathers who we were talking about went and fought, right? Like all these white people who believe in these. Anyway, I'm getting ahead of myself. Just getting way ahead of myself. For the sake of, you know, I'm just going to cut the history lesson short. And what are y'all's thoughts? You know, Pele, since you're our guest, how do you feel? Oh, no. I guess the history of it and, like, the present day. You know, like, what's the situation look like?
And the first thing I'm thinking about is how this story of like Africans going to England to get their education to become smart. That they did the same thing with the Black Panther in the comics. He apparently left Wakanda to go to England to study and stuff, and then became this genius because he went to, you know, study the white man's way of presenting information. But anyway,
that was besides that point. A white man was writing.
Yes.
T'Challa.
Yes, that's very true. But other than that, pop culture stuff. I appreciate that context for the Ghana story, because I didn't know that. I didn't know that it was. Those are the things that led to these revolutions, in a sense. So now with that kind of like understanding of like where it comes from, like, I, you know, really like the independence concept, just for what it does for people to feel like they have freedom. Just to, I, you know, center the mind around the concept of freedom, like, even if it's romanticized, because I know what it can do for the spirit of a revolution to kind of like know that something like this has happened before. And then also knowing that context makes me feel like there's a lot of finicky shit. Or, excuse me, can I curse on that?
Yeah.
Fuck yeah.
Okay, cool, yes. There's some finicky stuff going on up in here. It sounds like the American government and the English government have a lot to do with the countries still today. So this independence is more so like a quasi-dependence, more than an actual true independence. Like, there's codependency there, and you can hear it with the way that you were presenting the information as far as like World War II and how Africa was supporting like all the resources for these wars to happen, which, you know, we still siphon Africa. And I say we because we're American and we're like purchasing iPhones and shit, so we siphon Africa to use resources to do the things that we want to do, and we don't have any like real reciprocal relationship when it comes to that thing. So anyway, moving forward just to today, that independence is, you know, it's nice to say it, but also like I'm really curious about what it really means to Ghanaians in that country, like the day-to-day life outside of just today, and see how that effect is. So.
Yeah, I think what you said about the precedent or model or like hope for independence and freedom is something that I hadn't really considered, but like when I feel like now like people who are leading movements or activists or revolutionaries are like citing, right, like a lot of the people that you mentioned, and that it is helpful to know that change is possible and independence is possible, even if the ideal is not met, wasn't met and isn't met in the current day, but the, like, the impetus, like, the beginning stages have happened and can happen again. And yeah, I mean, I'm also curious kind of about, like, the present day and what that looks like and, like, what the independence means and what it means, I guess, from our perspective in this country, and, like, globally, like, what it actually looks like and the involvement in the United States, especially with the changing administrations, too, and...
As far as the thing about African foreign policy is that it's pretty consistent, you know, like, it doesn't matter, you know, it's that little meme where the two people are like, oh, you know, I'm so glad that, like, there's a new, you know, that Trump's not, you know, dropping the bombs on us anymore.
Yeah.
Like, meanwhile.
Yeah. There's like a bomb in the background, like, falling. And yeah. Like, thank goodness there, you know, thank goodness the first.
It's a rainbow-colored bomb.
Yeah, exactly.
We're so inclusive. Yeah.
So...
Goodness.
Yeah.
Well, I don't mind to interject. I'm curious about what you think about the African Union.
Yeah.
Because you said the governments are pretty much consistent.
Yeah.
And so now I'm curious about... Because you said that, I'm curious, what do you think about the African Union?
Yeah.
Like, what's your opinions on that?
So, I mean, I think that the idea behind the African Union is really valuable, right? Like, it's definitely, yeah, the idea is, so in a nutshell, the idea is valuable, the application is compromised from the start. And it's compromised for the same reasons. So, I guess to describe it. So, what, I mean, like, you know, it's similar to what we were talking about a while ago as far as, Joe Biden and Kamala Harris and people celebrating that. It's one thing to celebrate, right? And then to recognize where that celebration fits in with the big picture, right? It's another thing to, like, take the celebration and make that the whole thing, right? So, personally, when I think about Ghanaian independence and really, like, any African independence, you know, like, Haitian Revolution Day, you know, like, anything having to do with the Congo, yeah, anything having to do with, and even here, right, like, Juneteenth, all of these occasions, there's something to celebrate for sure. But, like, essentially what we're celebrating is, right, that Malcolm X quote, you know, if you stick the knife in the back and you pull it out 3 inches, right, but the knife is still in there, that's not actually progress. Progress happens when you start healing the wound. So a lot of these occasions, what we're celebrating is the knife coming out a little bit or coming out, right? But, like, we're not actually getting to the point of celebrating the healing because the healing hasn't happened. So, 1957, Ghana gets its independence, Kwame Nkrumah's the first president, you know, this famous moment, if you watch The Crown, you know, like, you know, Elizabeth II's, like, dancing with Kwame Nkrumah, and they're, like, everyone's, like, and her court is, like, oh, my gosh, like, she's
dancing
with...
Did you know they didn't clear this?
Yeah. And it's this big, like, impromptu celebrity moment, and, you know, I'm not gonna question so much the sincerity of, like, her intentions there, because... I don't think that matters so much in this case. But the point is, like, for the next, I think he was deposed in, like, 1966. So he was in charge for 9 years. He was a super socialist, you know, like, he was all about that Marxist class revolution and everything. And a big part of his economic program was to socialize and to industrialize, right? Like we were talking about with, like, Africa being used as a place for, like, resource extraction. Like, that's been going on since, right? Like, when we think about the Congo under King Leopold, late 1800s, early 1900s. Like, that is the history of Africa under European, like, occupation, essentially. It's just take out the resources, including the people, right? We have to think of, like, make sure we contextualize slavery as resource extraction, right? And as an extension or an expression of that. So, like... Even the, like, literally Europeans were like, we're going to take every single thing of value we can. Like, and going back again to World War II, this is kind of a tangent. But, like, you know, like, when we think about the uranium, the plutonium, like, these vital minerals that were used to make these bombs, they came out of the Congo. Like, we can trace back to the very mines that happened. So when we think that, you know, to Patrice Lumumba, right? Because he was assassinated in 1961. This was only 4 years after Ghana gained its independence, and 1 year after the Congo gained its independence, right? So the Congo gains its independence, Patrice Lumumba's president for 2 months, and then, like, the United States, Belgium, and some, like, you know, traitor, Uncle Tom, you know, Congolese, you know, kick him out, right? And then they assassinate him. But, like, a major part of that, or at least the U.S. involvement in that that whole thing, is that was the control of the uranium mines, right? Because, I mean, Congo's huge. It's as big as, like, Western Europe, you know, that one nation. And, like, in the south and the east, that's where, like, a whole bunch of the mines are, right? Even today, that's, like, 60% of the world's, like, copper resources, like 80% of the world's coltan and cobalt resources, stuff like that, and, you know, uranium mines and stuff. So, like, the United States is over there like, oh, how are we going to win the Cold War if they have control over their own, you know, uranium resources? So, you know, incentivized in that sense to, like, interfere and stuff. But, I mean, going back to Ghana, yeah, I mean, that's the situation. And so, like, Kwame Nkrumah's in there, and he's like, okay, what we need, right, is every other country in the world has done this, right? This is the Wealth of Nations, that capitalist text we were talking about. Like, it's basic, you know, like, capitalism, like, in the good sense, is that if you want to increase the wealth of your nation, you need to be able to transform your own resources into something, or at least transform other people's resources. So you have to have a manufacturing sector. So Kwame Nkrumah starts implementing factories, public social works projects, like he built a dam, a hydroelectric dam at the river, the Lake Volta, the River Volta, to produce electricity, to produce power. And he's doing all these things. But in order to, you know, implement projects like these, you need funding, right? And Kwame Nkrumah's thing, yeah, yeah, is like, okay, like, I don't want to go to the Western powers for funding, but no one else is going to give me funding, right? Patrice Lumumba ran into similar issues. Like, when his whole thing started going down, he was like, yo, okay, United States, you want to help us out? The United States was like, no, we're not going to help you gain independence. Belgium was definitely not going to do it. So he went to the Soviet Union, right? Not even being like, yo, we're trying to be socialists, we're trying to be communists, help us out. He was just like, hey, you know, you're a major world power. We need someone in our corner. You want to help us out? Then the United States turns around and says, hey, you know, like, we see you asking the Soviet Union for help. Like, that's a sign, you know, y'all are evil. And, you know, Patrice Lumumba's like, nah, we literally asked you first. So, like, similar situation happened with Kwame Nkrumah beforehand. And long story short, he had to go to the IMF, World Bank, like, those financial institutions to get loans. And the thing about these systems, right, is, like, once you take a loan out from them, it, I mean, they're like loan sharks. You know, the loan comes with all these conditions. You have to cut back on all these programs. Like, they tell you how you can spend the money and stuff like that. So he's doing his best he can to, like, you know, like, implement these economic, you know, growth projects, while also, you know, having all these strict, you know, stipulations and, you know, all this red tape, navigating all this red tape with how he can spend the money. Meanwhile, you know, I mean, like you just asked with Cuba, the United States, I mean, because, like, by 1966, assassination attempts left and right, like, the United States is trying to, and not even just assassination attempts, like, coups, you know, to kick people out. Kwame Nkrumah had several coup attempts against him, you know, obviously instigated from the inside, to the point that one of the things that you'll hear this with a lot of people, whether it's African leaders or South American leaders or Middle Eastern leaders or even Southeast Asia, anywhere, right, the U.S. has gone to, like, kind of, like, impose this kind of control. One of the things you'll hear, points of criticism, is, oh, this person's a dictator, right? They said it with Morales, they said it with Maduro today in, like, Venezuela. Like, people will go into these leaders will go into the Constitution and say, okay, I know we said we were going to elect people, you know, like, but I'm going to, pretty much, he made himself the president beyond the constitutional limits.
Mm-hmm. Like what's happening in Haiti.
Right, like exactly what's happening in Haiti. Which, you know, it's crazy because the United States will literally be on both sides of this argument. Like, yeah. There will be, if it benefits them, they'll be like, y'all need to, like, you know, fuck that, you know, democratically elected leader. We don't like him. And if it's someone who's changing the Constitution, they'll be like, oh, you know, that's anti-democratic. You know, they're changing the Constitution. So we got to go in there and enforce that. Either way, no matter how it goes, like, what their priority, the United States priority is, we need the person that we want in there. And usually it's like the person we want because of how they're going to, you know, spend the resources. Like,
and that's on both sides.
Yeah.
In the United States, both political parties.
Yeah.
Do that.
Yeah.
Just to clarify.
Looking at how Democrats, you know, supported the whole Venezuela thing. And, you know, again,
and
this
in
is
Haiti,
recent.
While being afraid that Trump was going to become a dictator and telling him he was being unconstitutional, right. While sanctioning everything that's happening in Haiti.
Boom.
Yeah.
And then we look at, right, like a lot of this Haiti stuff. I mean, it obviously goes back way back, but like a lot of it goes back to Clinton as well. You know, like the first major Democratic presidents of our, you know, of our lifetime for sure. So, that, you know, that's all just something to keep in mind. And the reason, like, you know, I'm going back here is because this kind of all set the stage for, like, how international politics with the Third World works today. You know, like, the liberated African countries with all their resources set the stage, right? Like, the assassination of Patrice Lumumba was a big deal because it was the first time, like, you know, like, up until that point, everyone was looking at Africa, right? And they say, like, the civil rights movement, that was in part catalyzed by that assassination because, like, African Americans here were literally looking and following, like, the news in the rest of the world, being like, what's America gonna do here? Like, are we just gonna, like, respect these people's calls to, like, literally live up to the ideals of, like, America, right? The stated ideals, like, oh, democracy, self-determination, self-government. Are we gonna let them do that, right, in the Congo? Or are we gonna go in and do something else and figure out some way to make it not happen? And then the alternative happened. And not only did the alternative happen, but it literally happened in, like, the bloodiest way it could have happened. You know, so, like, again, all this stuff setting the stage for, in America's foreign policy, it set the stage for how America was going to act for the next however many years.
I think we started here with Pele's question about the African Union.
Ah, sorry, yeah.
you addressed that.
My point so there much. Is that, outside of having a leader like Kwame Nkrumah or Patrice Lumumba who have visions and, like, the clear intention of advocating for liberation and self-determination and self-government, every other leader who is still in power, and especially, like, today when we think about, like, the leaders like Museveni in Uganda, who's been in power since 1986, right? Yeah, or, like, Mobutu in the DRC, who was in power from, like, 67 up until 98 when he was assassinated or something. All these leaders get to stay in power essentially, or even Paul Kagame, who's been in power since like 1994 or something. They stay in power because the United States is over there saying, hey, as long as you keep being a brutal dictator who's going to promise to use the resources of your country for our benefit instead of for the benefit of your people, you can stay in power. So as long as, like, right, again, in concept, the African Union, it's a good idea, right? Africa must unite. That's the Kwame Nkrumah quote. But for as long as the leaders who are uniting have the best interests of the West in mind over the best interest, and really, like,
in
self-interest.
Themselves, yeah. I mean, it's the power.
Yeah. Like, right. Mobutu, according to some estimates, he amassed, like, $4 billion by the time he lost power. That's, like, over four decades, $4 billion. Just, like, being a middleman, you know, between the West and himself. Yeah. So, I mean, that's my answer.
The part, that last part, it makes me think about this book that I've been reading that talks about merchants and in, like, a older sense, and how they are, like, you know, what did he say? Oh, shit. He said that they were, like, basically vile, and, like, they didn't have a place in society because they didn't have any dignity for, like, how they operated, and they basically were just middlemen,
right.
Or, you know, middle people, depending on who's selling it. And so I think about that, like, you know, leveraging your power to say no until somebody gives you an offer that you like, and then saying yes because you can make some money off of it. As you know, I have my feelings about that, but that's neither here or there. What I was interested the most about what you were saying, if I can like recall the proper words that you used, give me a second.
Take your time.
I have to cipher through it.
Thoughts?
Oh, you want us to wait, Pele, while you're thinking?
Oh, no, no. Go for it.
Okay. Well, I mean, part of me was just thinking about, like, the necessity of the African Union being completely based on colonization, right? Which then I feel like in some ways, and this is like a totally different like lens to be considering this through, but I just thought that I had, like, Africa is so often from the West's perspective considered to be a country, and like there's a lack of acknowledgement around, you know, like multiple, all the different countries, all the different cultures, all the different languages, and how like all the borders have been carved up and like totally changed. And then thinking about like the I guess the idea behind the African Union, you know, I'm thinking about like half of the world like trying to unite to like push back on a force and what that would require. And like, you know, how you were talking about, I mean, that it's difficult to do when everyone doesn't have the same belief, and then this like feeling that everyone should have the same belief despite like all the different cultures and everything else and all the different histories, right? But there's like this one kind of central force around colonization and like pushing back and freedom. And then thinking about like what it means to be free and independent,
I remember. So you said what year was it when Patrice Lumumba was assassinated?
61 50 years ago this year.
Oh, wow. Look at that. Numbers.
Or 60.
I started thinking about, like, how you were saying that they were organizing in the Congo. Was that the Congo that was organizing?
Yeah.
They were organizing in the Congo, and I think about how Martin Luther King utilized the same routes to create, like, political allies.
Yeah, coalitions.
Yeah. To, you know, that allowed the civil rights movement to kind of really push. And I didn't know that piece about, you know, African Americans watching Patrice Lumumba and what was happening in the Congo, that, you know, would push something like the civil rights movement. So that's like, you know, it's just as interesting as like finding out that the Haitian Revolution, like, you know, oppressed Capoeira in Brazil,
right,
to the point that Capoeira today is probably like what it is because of that revolution. Just like the, no matter where in the world black people exist, because they treat us like a monolith so much, they, you know, we're influenced by whatever's happening anywhere, you know, the country of Africa.
Yeah.
And then the other part was around the African Union. You were talking about the leaders that are in power. That's the issue, why the African Union sounds like a good idea, but the people who are in leadership now, who are even in, you know, formulated this, I guess, like board or whatever they have. I don't know what it is at this point. It makes sense that, like, you know, that would be a concern. And it could take time because, like, you know, there are new, there's new leadership coming up in Africa. I've been paying attention to, like, you know, what's happening with, like, female presidents coming to rise in some countries in Africa. And also, like, younger leadership coming to, like, you know, mayorship and whatever that may be. And they have a different mindset. They're more connected to how we operate here in America. With, you know, some different variations and stuff. And you can actually, like, navigate this, like, through Twitter. Like, you can see the conversations that these young politicians are having with, like, just the diaspora. Like, not even just the people in their own country, but the diaspora. So I think the organization is happening, and I think it's just all about a matter of time. But, you know, like, we're super impatient. We want revolutions to, like, happen now. So I definitely understand, like, the pushback on, like, the African Union. That makes sense.
Really, I want the revolution to have happened 60 years ago. Yeah. And that's the thing, right? Like, so on the African Union, I mean, it's just, I think a lot of people hear the word union and they're like, oh, that's good, right? We associate unity with a positive, right? But like, people unite, right? Like the hatocracy, the boondocks, the hatar. People unite around things that like are terrible for people. Mm-hmm. You know, like this, if you watch the boondocks, you already know. If you don't, there's just some old people who got together because they hated everything. They're like, oh, you hate everything too? And then they were real bad though. Like, they were fun characters. So that's the African Union in a sense, right? It'd be one thing, right? The Pan-African Union is like, we must unite against these evil forces, right? Against, you know, capitalism, imperialism, you know, racism, sexism, like all these things. But this African Union is just like, we must unite, you know, like have tea, you know, like maintain, perpetuate the status quo. And then,
so. The main agenda item is the tea.
Yeah. And then this, one of the things you mentioned as far as like the interconnectedness, right, of not just African narratives, but Afro-diasporic narratives. Like, it really is like, I mean, African people, ever since what the Ma'afa, you know, the great catastrophe, ever since, you know, which is the slave trade and, you know, everything that came just before and right after it, African people have stayed connected, right? And that's just one of the things that always, you know, I think it's one of the most beautiful things, because it's like, right, like the star, you know, for Ghanaian Independence Day, the black star in the middle of the flag, that was chosen to reflect Marcus Garvey's contribution to the struggle, right? Like, Marcus Garvey, in a sense, being the father of Pan-Africanism, was a huge inspiration for, right? Because he died, what, in like the 1940s, you know? So like, all of these African leaders who came up were the next generation, right? They were people who grew up with stories, just like, you know, the people here in the States, right? Grew up with stories hearing about this Marcus Garvey character, you know, who's going around like, you know, black people must unite, you know, like
doing some crazy dangerous things.
Yeah,
marching 100%. In the middle of the city with an army,
indeed,
and a whole first team of nurse that were ready to heal the men and during battle, flying jet planes in the middle of New York. Dude, yeah. It's tripping. That's tripping. In 1940s, I'm all about that.
Indeed. So that was, yeah, I mean, like, and yeah, I mean, it's crazy because like before him, I can't think of anyone who came before him and did what he did, right? And just because he did that as like one person who organized all these people came after him. So, you know, it's just kind of like one of those things that speaks to the impact that one person can have on all these different people, which is, I guess, why I get so, you know, uptight about like people like Barack Obama, you know, because like, as even if he was like, yeah, I'm gonna be president, I'm not gonna do shit for black people, except for symbolically, like, say things or support in certain agendas or ideas and stuff, that alone could have a huge impact. If he was like, yo, Israel should be free. Palestine should be free, because he's all about Israel.
Yeah,
Palestine should be free. Or like, oh, yo, the Congo should be liberated, you know, like, and everyone who's there paid fairly, you know.
Or yeah, we should get our military bases off of the African continent,
right? Like, even if he's not doing that stuff, people all over the world would hear that. They'd be like, whoa. You know, like, it's just kind of, I shouldn't have gone down that rabbit hole, because it's a rabbit hole.
But so can I ask,
yeah,
So one of your main points just now about Marcus Garvey was that, I mean, really, like, that one person can make a pretty substantial change. And in terms of the diaspora, I'm kind of curious about, like, for the two of you, you know, like, what you feel like, how you feel connected, and what you, like, maybe share a little bit about what each of you are doing and what other people can be doing, too.
I'm going to turn it over to you, Mr. Kwadjo Danso.
I mean, like, I feel connected to all these narratives, right? Like, I grew up feeling connected to, like, the Ghanaian narrative, And in a way that's like, you know, both empowering and then also like, you know, not empowering. Because one of the things about like Africa today, you know, I think part of the colonial legacy is that part of, right, so this is an example. Part of like the traditional Ghanaian narrative is, you know, obviously being the first nation to, you know, achieve liberation, but also not being Nigerian, you know? That's part of the narrative. You know, and I suspect that's part of the narrative for a lot of West African countries.
Oh, man.
But like, you know, it's a relatively problematic narrative because it alienates our neighbors, right? Who we need in this struggle. So I grew up with that, you know, like kind of like internalizing the positive and like really internalizing the negative without realizing it. And I'm glad I realized that at some point because I was like, yo, okay, you know, I gotta like, you know, chill out and, you know, be less, I gotta stop hating on Nigerians. So
the jollof rice still not as good.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I was wondering when that was coming.
I was waiting on it.
That Ghana jollof, we stay with it. Yeah. But I mean, there's that. And then like, you know, expanding, right? Because once you start getting rid of that like kind of nationalist narrative for no reason, right, because like, oh, Ghana's better than everyone else, right? That's another part of it. You know, I think a lot of different countries have that thing going on. Once you get rid of that, the question is, okay, so like, what are we gonna, you know, how am I gonna identify now? And that's when I started, you know, identifying more as African, more so with African narratives, including continental and Afro-diasporic. And then again, you know, just following those narratives, like you mentioned, you know, how the Haitian Revolution had ripples that affected Capoeira in Brazil, how it affected, you know, like...
the taking away of the drum in America.
Exactly. Right here. And then, like, throughout the Caribbean as well. And then how all of that stuff... I mean, it's just so crazy. There's just so many different, like, back and forths, you know? Like, and one of the things I'm really sympathetic to is, like, this argument of reparations, where it's like, reparations here in America... Or, okay, so, like, the argument ultimately comes down to the only just way to do reparations for African people in any country, in particular in America, is to give reparations pretty much across the diaspora. Because there was so much, not only traffic, but, like, influence happening. You know, it's like everything that African Americans were able to accomplish in the name of freedom is owed in huge part to Haiti, right? Is owed to that example. Is owed to, like, you know, the example of, you know, the slave revolts, slave rebellions in Jamaica, like Queen Nani, you know, like Yaya Santawa in, you know, in Ghana, you know, like Queen Nzinga in Angola. Like, all of these narratives contributed to the spirit of revolution in each one of these countries, right? In the United States, in Brazil, in Jamaica, in Haiti, that, you know, resulted in revolution. And then each one of these nations, essentially, you know, because you look at all the, like, major players in our, you know, discourse now, Frantz Fanon in Algeria, you know, Marcus Garvey in Jamaica, like, you know, take your pick of people in the States, you know, Booker T. Washington, you know, even Du Bois, right, to an extent. And then again, yeah. Even, yeah, I mean, to an extent. And, you know, I mean, he came around later, you know, post-Garvey, yeah. And then, you know, like, Kwame Ture, right? Like, all these great Pan-Africanists, you know, like, here. And then we go across the sea. We see, you know, Kwame Nkrumah, Patrice Lumumba in the DRC, Inyede in, I don't know where, Sekou Touré in Guinea. Like, just so many people contributing so much. Anyway, so that's my whole thing is the narratives. I'm really attached to the interconnectedness of the struggle, which is why, I mean, that's why I identify as a Pan-Africanist, because, like, for people so large, we are a small community, right? Like, the impact that one of us has in any of our communities resonates. We all feel it, in part because we're experiencing so much of the same things, like you mentioned earlier. So, yeah, I mean, that's my thing. I'll get into the work later.
Why later?
Yeah, I mean, it just
because we want to hear from you.
Yeah.
Oh.
Good answer. Yeah.
I feel the same way about the interconnectedness. That was my path. Once I guess radicalized, I recognized the stuff that Booker T was doing, how he was supporting supporting Marcus Garvey. I almost felt like I was snitching on Booker T for a second. I caught myself in the middle of that, but like this is a past process. Yeah. Anyway, I'm sorry, but I just had like immediate street code was like, wait. But so how Booker T was helping Marcus Garvey, how, you know, Booker T supported just so many different things, but at the same time was also pushing education and building a strong fortitude in Tuskegee, Alabama, and then also like laying the groundwork for the Greenwood community, so that it could be successful because of like the successful skills that were developed and the markets and stuff that they saw in Tuskegee, and then take that and, you know, manifest Tulsa in the way that they did. For me, like, just like recognizing everything that my like ancestors in the struggle has done, interconnected, like even like, you know, I don't like how W. E. Du Bois sold out Marcus Garvey, but at the same time, like, you know, I understand like all of this stuff matters, because it's understanding the shadow side of the movement as well. Like, there's everybody's trying to do the right thing, and you recognize that one path is counterproductive to another, but it also helps it to grow because it's like sharpening you for the next time that the momentum picks up, and sharpens you for the next time. So, you know, some of our movements recently, like the stories, like we were saying, they were all inspired by Marcus Garvey, and we're all inspired by like people like Fred Hampton and the freedom fighters in the Haitian Revolution, or the Capoeiristas in Brazil, all that kind of stuff. We're like standing on those shoulders and recognizing what it's like to have to deal with our peers as they manifest in this day and age, which there's a lot of them on Instagram calling y'all out.
I hope y'all are watching.
But also, you know, also recognizing how to incorporate them into the mission, recognizing that they have a place, recognizing that like their message is just as important as the message that I'm sending, because the moment that they decide to change their mind for better or worse, they also take a select amount of people with them into that direction. And, you know, if it's for the worse, then I'm like really big on etymology and stuff, but you know, it gets blanked out of the gene pool and out of the thought pool and the consciousness and stuff, and then we can move into the direction we want to. I know everybody wants to save a lot of people, but I also think that like sometimes for the sake of moving forward, we have to like amputate certain pieces. So, but if they transition, you know, to the other direction, then you gain a much more stronger companion because of the tension that you had before, and then recognizing the similarities and the new understanding. And that will be the way that we should go into like how we navigate those our issues. Like, you know, we get a espionage or whatever, learning how to truly make people feel with empathy connected to our community. So, you know, it helps to reshape how they embrace what it is that we're trying to do and see themselves in it. So yeah, that's the interconnectedness piece. I mean, it goes to just very human factors, even if it's not just about being Pan-African. Like, we're all just very connected to everything. Like, we share a lot of DNA with, I'm gonna say it, you guys, we share a lot of DNA with mushrooms.
I thought you were going to say bananas.
And bananas, yes. But mushrooms more so than any other like plant food that we eat. And then like that mushroom also tells like trees how to like, you know, defend itself against other diseases and stuff. So we're like just everything's so integrated. And the more that we keep compartmentalizing things with isms and this, and it frustrates me because I don't like that conversation, because it feels like we're snatching ourselves away, we're compartmentalizing too much, we're taking ourselves away from understanding the common factors that allow us to work together more than the separations. It's very engineered mindset based. It's like, let me understand this cog and this cog and this cog and see what parts I can take out and replace until something works, versus like taking a step back and understanding that it already works, and then trying to figure out how to support it in its function. Anyway, that's my thought on it. That's where I sit on that.
That's what's up. I So one of the things, I mean, you both have thrown out a lot of names, and I know that we haven't gotten to the work part yet, so before we get to that, you both have thrown out a lot of names. It's been pretty noticeable that a lot of them are men. In fact, all of the, like, more recent people you've talked about have been men, so I'm curious, because I'm sure that people, if anybody's listening, you know, are, like, listening and figuring out, like, oh, I should go check these people out, I should go, like, read some stuff they've written. So do you have suggestions for Pan-African women, or people to check out?
Yes.
Who are not men.
So this is, like, something that I recently learned. My mom taught me this, just recently. I never knew about this. There's, what's the abolitionist that, worked with, Frederick Douglass?
Which one? Sojourner Truth, Peter D. Anthony.
No, it's a white man.
Oh, Garrison Lloyd Webber.
I can't remember his
name. I'm thinking of Andrew Lloyd Webber. William something Garrison.
I think his name. So this guy, it was Harriet, Frederick Douglass, and this guy. Can't remember his name. He was out in Missouri. He was doing crazy shit. He was really radical. He was more radical than...
Oh, John Brown.
Yeah.
There we go. Yeah! John Brown.
Like, bigger, bigger. Yeah.
That's it. All right, so, and just recognizing, like, this is the interconnectedness piece. Like, you hear about Harriet Tubman and what she did with the Underground Railroad as far as pioneering the way and, you know, freeing how many ever slaves she freed. And then you hear about Frederick Douglass, and then, you know, you don't really hear about John Brown. However, like, recognizing that they were working together to, like, understand concepts of how to get freedom, and seeing the part that Harriet Tubman played in radicalizing Frederick Douglass in some of his ways, and then also learning how to not be so radical like John Brown, and trying to, like, put, like, a, what's the word on it, like a barrier between how far to go, like that. I was inspired by that. I was like, God damn, like, my fucking, like, history understanding just, like, exploded when I learned that. Like, so, you know, shout out to you, Mom. You put me on that. And then also, her favorite black history, I mean, that's because she also did, like, she was in cosmetology, but Madam C.J. Walker. Mm-hmm. And actually understanding what she did for employment and, like, what she did for the people that she was around versus just her being a millionaire or whatever. Mm-hmm. Because... like, I don't know if you've ever seen this, like, really gangster video or picture of her. And she's riding in, like, this, like, you know, I guess it's like a Model T or whatever.
Yeah.
It's chopped off or whatever. She's, like, leaning back. She's got, like, hey, three other girls in the car.
The trend.
Yeah, and she's, like, she's, like, chilling. Like, she's not worried about nothing. She looks like she's not worried about nothing. And, you know, also knowing that she was funding, like, you know, people to free themselves. And so, like, I feel like that stuff is very important and powerful. And the way that you see women operate in the Pan-African movement is so much more, it's different from what you see, what we talk about in the history books. The history books is all like for glory and like this or that or death, and people are getting assassinated, and then you see the, like, these women are like doing very much more strategic routes that have less bodies and on the you know, on their path to their freedom and liberation. So I thank you for bringing that up, because I notice that I do that a lot when I think about, like, the movement. I don't think about the women too much as far as how they lead and pioneer. And then every time I go into a meeting or any kind of organization, the only people that are there are women.
Yeah.
Every single time.
Yeah.
And I'm like, damn, what the freak is going on here? You know what I'm saying? And, like, even with my podcast, like, majority of the people who I, like, actually look for to talk are people with work. It's all women. I'm like, oh my goodness, like, this is, we gotta step up. Anyway, you know, meet up, you know.
Yeah, and I feel like I'm in a similar situation. Like, I definitely, because even in the few names that I've mentioned, thought about the women and been like, who's a woman that, like, people are gonna know, right? Like, with the same magnitude, you know? Mm-hmm. So, like, with, in the DRC, like, a woman who's commonly associated, she worked with Patrice Lumumba. She's credited with, like, I mean, she was just, you know, she was a real one. And her name is Andrée Blouin, like, A-N-D-R-E-E-B-L-O-U-I-N. She was born in the Central African Republic, and she's lit, you know, and, like, with the Friends of the Congo, right? Like, one of the people groups we work with in Kinshasa, in the capital, they operate out of the Andrée Blouin Center. So she's one. Ella Baker, like back in the day. It's again same time period. She was like an OG organizer. Obviously, what's her name? Yeah, compelling argument, right? what's it? I can't remember. Ida B. Wells.
I was wondering if that's who you were thinking of, but I was gonna let you struggle through it.
Yeah,
that's a really good one.
Ida B. Wells and Mary Church Terrell, you know, so like, you know, Mary Church Terrell came on a little after Ida B. Wells, but like they were, you know, actually I heard, you know, from what I understand, I think through Angela Davis, who's another one, they had a kind of contentious relationship, you know, Ida B. Wells and Mary Church Terrell, but like, you know, in my like no race thing, my anti-race philosophy, I guess, Mary Church Terrell is one of the people who, you know, like, you know, I've been, you know, when I look back at history, the thing she said, she's one of those people who's like, yeah, like, this concept of race, this isn't ours. Yeah. So, like, you know, why am I trying to, like, you know, abide by that? So there's that. And, like, in the present day, you know, Angela Davis, Michelle Alexander, for sure, like, you know, lawyer, civil rights lawyer, and activist, and author. And I think, you know, just as far as, like, books that will have an impact, hers, you know, like the New Jim Crow is like one of the big ones, because that's a huge problem that it's crazy that we still we're not really addressing. And I mean, there's Asada for sure, like, you know, the Black Panther, the women of the Black Panther, and yeah, that's the thing. Oh, Fannie Lou Hamer.
I see, and that's a huge thing, right? The women of the Black Panthers.
Yeah.
And that's part of it, right? Because there is a huge gap, even in what both of you are sharing about like really influential women. There's a gap between, like, for, like, 40 or 50 years, right, that y'all are mentioning, that we're, that, like, there's just a space there. I mean, there's a lot of women who are leading a lot of things.
And even going back to the Haitian Revolution.
Change. Yeah.
Like, one of the things about the Haitian Revolution is it's widely accepted that, like, the women, you know, like, played a central, like, if not the leading role in, like, making that happen. Both in like actual battle as well as in support, you know.
Yeah. I forgot to mention Marcus Garvey's wife. She like took a bullet for, or she jumped in the way of a bullet for him, like, and fell down the steps and everything just to like make sure. Yo, that like.
Yeah.
And I'm not jumping in front of no bullet.
You know, I think.
I don't know. I'm not in the moment, but she was ready.
I mean, I would just encourage. Like, look for the women. Whenever the men's names are out there, look to their partners, look to whoever they're working with. Like, I think of Patricia Rodney. Is that her name? Walter Rodney's wife?
Yeah, Patricia.
Like, she's continuing his work and has been continuing his work, right? And that's often the case of what happens. Like, the man is never in it alone, or is very rarely in it alone, and the men are never in it alone.
Yeah, I'm all about that. I understand that a lot, because I mean, even when I think about Martin Luther King, I always think about all the people who made Martin Luther King, like the people who walked with him, the people who supported him, the people who believed in him. Like, when I think of these names, I don't actually just think of a person, and that's probably the reason why I'm okay with just like using like these names, because I think about everyone who contributed to it. Like, I even think about like like the celebrities now, like, there's a lot of people who contribute to the team of what that person is. Mm-hmm. That person didn't do that by themselves. Like, even like operating this business that I'm trying to operate, I'm thinking about how many people I'm gonna need to actually make this thing happen. Oh my God, like, it's gonna be a plethora of people, and I hope their names go, you know, known for the work as well. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate you like making sure that that's brought to our forefront of our consciousness.
Yeah, because I think, you know, when we don't use the names, or we don't, really underscore the role, it just has become like Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, you know, instead of considering like everything and everybody who's contributed, which, you know, also is a much more powerful message for everybody to understand, right? Like, considering having a role in the movement.
Have you seen that picture with that lady like punching the cop's face and
the
baton?
I love that. Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
Like, it's black and white. It's like a classic,
like a
picture.
Yeah.
I always think about this, and that's how I think about like the women in the movement.
Yeah.
Like, the men are just like the mouthpiece, and then the women be ready to
not just ready, they're doing it.
Yes, yeah. You're like punching them in the face, and we're like, oh, shit. Yeah.
And cooking, right. And making clothes, yeah.
Yeah, shit's going down.
Yeah. So in the last couple minutes, unless there's like super a lot more you want to share.
I do just want to mention, I mean, and this isn't for cookies or like brownie points, but just, you know, cookies. I did mention, you know.
I was
going to
say, I want some cookies. Yeah, I do. Break it for the cookies. Yeah.
I did mention before you brought that up, three women who do get left out of the discourse a lot, especially because we do have this recency bias of like people like who we can remember pretty recently, but like Queen Nani in Jamaica, Queen Nzinga in Angola / you know the Congo Kingdom, Congo Empire, and Nana Ya Asantua, and they span essentially from like the 1700s to the late 1800s, but each one of those three are like OG women who are worth looking into as well, because right, it's kind of one of those things. In their time, I have a hard time thinking of the men who were influential, you know?
Yeah.
And like, the only people I can really think of go back to either, you know, like Zumbi in Brazil, or like, you know, the Haitian men.
I mean, but even then, Dandara was is a driving force in Brazil, so.
Indeed.
Yeah, which I think also means like, women didn't just disappear. And I know that you did mention them, and part of my question too is like thinking more recently, or like from the 1970s on, so that there are like, you know, people. Hey everyone, we're changing pace a little bit. The camera battery lost its juice, so we're here back at our place and Pele is back at his place, but we wanted to make sure that we did give you a few names of some current Pan-African women for you to check out.
Indeed. Current as in more contemporary. Fatia Nkrumah, Pauline Opango, Samia Nkrumah as well, and Patricia Rodney. She's super current, you know, still drawing breath on this earth, you know, long live Patricia Rodney, Dr. Patricia Rodney, and also Dr. Marimba Ani. And, you know, just an interesting note about a few of those, like if you know those names, you're familiar, Nkrumah, Opango, Pauline Opango, Lumumba, oftentimes, you know, like these, you know, great Pan-African men, if you look at, you know, the people beside them, the people who are supporting them, the great Pan-African women, you know, at least three of those people we've just mentioned are, you know, wives of really notable Pan-African men. So something to keep in mind, you know, how they say behind every great man, right? So in the Pan-African sense, it's literally like beside, you know, every great woman is a great Pan-African man, you know. So you look up those names, check them out, and, you know, we'll see y'all in the future. Catch you on the flip side.